This is the Bible Explained by Pastor Michael Yeo. Before we begin, let us prepare our hearts through worship.
God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time, with no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of light. And as you speak, see your heart and everything you've made. Every burning star, a signal fire of grace. If creation sings your praises, oh life. Stars were made to worship so loud. If the mountains bow in reverence so loud. If the oceans roar your brightness so loud. For if everything exists to lift you high, so
Shalom and welcome to our online Bible study once again. And today we are going to talk on how Jesus has power to change lives. And we are considering a passage from Luke chapter 8, verse 26 to 39. Now this is an account of Jesus sending the demons into a herd of pigs. Now verse 26 goes this way. Then they, Jesus and his disciples, sailed to the country of the Gadarenes or Gerasenes in some versions, which is opposite Galilee. Now, both Gadarenes and Gerasenes refer to a similar region across the lake from Galilee, a Gentile region probably southeast of the Sea of Galilee, home of the Decapolis or the Ten Cities. Now, these were Greek cities that belonged to no country and were self-governing. This was Gentile territory. There would not have been a herd of pigs in Jewish territory, for Jews considered pigs to be unclean. Now verse 27 goes this way, and when Jesus stepped out on the land, there met him a certain man from the city who had demons for a long time, and he wore no clothes, nor did he live in a house, but in the tombs. Now in those days, it was common for cemeteries to have many tombs carved into the hillside, making cave-like mausoleums. Now there was enough room for a person to live in such tombs. Now, verse 28 to 29 goes this way. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and he fell down before him, and with a loud voice he said, "What have I to do with you, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me." For he had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man, for he had often seized him, and he was kept under guard, bound with chains and shackles, and he broke the bonds and was driven by the demon into the wilderness. Now, the demons saw Jesus and recognized him and his authority immediately. And so the demons caused the man to fall down before Jesus, not in worship, but in grudging submission to Jesus' superiority. Now, the man shrieked and demanded, "Why are you bothering me?" Now, such a question shows the demon's ultimate rebellion to God. The demon also used Jesus' divine name, Jesus, Son of the Most High God. Now, this shows that demons recognize Jesus, understand who he is, know his power, and also seem to know their own ultimate fate. Now, verse 30 says this. Jesus asked him, saying, "What is your name?" And he said, "Legion," because many demons had entered him. Now, whether Jesus was asking this poor man for his name or asking the demon for his name is uncertain. But the demon answered, saying that its name was Legion. Now, a legion was the largest unit in the Roman army, having been between 3,000 and 6,000 soldiers. Now, thus this man was filled with many, many demons. And in verse 31, "And they begged him that he would not command them to go out into the abyss." Now, the demons undoubtedly knew that Jesus planned to free their prisoner. However, their primary concern at this point was where Jesus would send them. They knew where they did not want to go. Now, they also knew that they had no power over Jesus and would have to submit to him. And so, they begged Jesus not to send them into the abyss or the bottomless pit. As mentioned in Revelation 9 and Revelation 20, the abyss or bottomless pit is the place of confinement for Satan and his demons. Now, why did not Jesus send the demons to the abyss or the bottomless pit? Now, Matthew 8:29 gives us an idea. It says that the demon asked not to be sent to the bottomless pit or abyss before the appointed time. The demons knew the ultimate fate, but the time for such work had not yet come. Now, the same question could perhaps be asked today. Why doesn't Jesus stop all the evil in the world? The time for that has actually not yet come, but it will come. The book of Revelation portrays the future victory of Jesus over Satan, his demons, and all evil. Now, verse 32 to 33 says this. "Now a herd of many swine was feeding there on the mountain. So they begged him that he would permit them to enter them. And Jesus permitted them. And then the demons went out of the man, entered the swine, and the herd ran violently down the steep place into the lake and drowned." Now the Gospel of Mark reports that this large herd of pigs numbered about 2,000. The demons pled with Jesus to let them enter into the pigs. And so Jesus gave them permission. The point is this. Satan has no final authority, but can only do what God permits for the short time that he is allowed to be the God of this world. Now, it is also clear from this story that Jesus valued this one man far more than any number of pigs. Now, verse 34 says, "The herdsmen on the hill responsible for the safety of the pigs were astounded when their herd suddenly ran away down the hill and into the Sea of Galilee." Now, terrified, surprised, and afraid that they would somehow be blamed for the disaster, they fled to the nearby city and the surrounding countryside, spreading the news as they ran. And certainly, those who heard the news had to go and see for themselves. So a crowd soon surrounded Jesus, the disciples, and the newly freed man. And then verse 34 to 37, "When those who fed them saw what had happened, they fled and told it in the city and in the country. And then they went out to see what had happened and came to Jesus and found the man from whom the demons had departed, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. They also who had seen it told them by what means he who had been demon-possessed was healed. Then the whole multitude of the surrounding region of the gatherings asked him to depart from them, for they were seized with great fear. And he got into the boat and returned. There could be no mistaking it. The demon-possessed man had been healed. But the people, overcome with fear, told Jesus that they wanted him to leave. Now, if they were afraid because of the loss of their livestock, it was foolish for them actually to value possessions, investment, and even animals above human life. Unfortunately for them, Jesus did as they asked. He returned to the boat and he left. And there is no biblical record that Jesus ever returned. Sometimes the worst that can happen is for Jesus to answer a poorly considered request. Now, verse 38 to 39. Now the man from whom the demons had departed begged him that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, Return to your own house and tell what great things God has done for you. And he went his way and proclaimed throughout the whole city what great things Jesus had done for him. Now, Jesus had other plans for this man. This man would be returning to his home in a Gentile region. And Jesus knew that this man would be an effective witness to those who remembered his previous condition and could attest to the miraculous healing. Now, through him then, Jesus' ministry would expand into this Gentile area. Now, some reflections here. Number one is this: Jesus has spiritual power to deliver people from demon possession and to transform lives. Now, it is interesting to compare this miracle with the one that immediately precedes it, the stilling of the storm. Now, in the previous miracle, we see Christ's power over nature. Here we see his power over the supernatural. Now, in the previous miracle, we see Christ's ability to tame the wild sea. Here we see his ability to tame a wild man. And in the previous miracle, we see Christ giving peace in a storm. Here he gives peace in a soul. The second thing is this: Jesus' power is necessary for transformation. Man's efforts at transformation fall short. Now, the human attempt to deal with this man had been to bind him with chains, but it did not work. Human solutions to problems that are spiritual in nature ultimately will fail. There is also another application here. And the third is this: Christ commands those whose lives he has transformed to proclaim it. Now, how can we do that? There are actually two very normal parts to proclaiming the gospel that every one of us can do. And number one is to live a changed life, live a transformed life. People knew that this guy as a naked, wild, and violent man. But when they went out to see him, he was sitting down, clothed, and in his right mind. There was obvious change and transformation. So how can I show people that Christ has made a difference in my life? Now, there are many ways, actually. Number one is that our attitudes can show people that we are Christians. Do we have a cheerful, thankful heart even in difficult times? Or do we grumble and complain at the slightest discomfort? Now, Paul says that if we do all things without grumbling or disputing, we show ourselves as lights in this crooked and perverse world. Philippians 2. Now, what about your words? Do you encourage and build others up, or do you tear them down? And what about our behavior? Are we self-centered, or are we always thinking about others and how we can serve them? Do we live for the same values and goals the world lives for? Do we blend in with the world, or do we stand out as distinct? If we walk in reality with Jesus as our Lord every day, our life will be a witness. Now, another thing we should do now that we have experienced God's goodness is this: return home and share what great things God has done for you. In other words, go back to the people who knew you before Christ, to your family, to your friends, to the relationships that you already have. The New Testament pattern for evangelism is that you go back into your own circle of influence, your family, friends, neighbors, job, school, common interest groups, community contacts, and tell them what great things God has done for you. Now let us continue to share the good news of Jesus. John Wesley was once riding his horse, singing a favorite hymn, when a robber accosted him with the words, "Your money or your life." And John Wesley obediently emptied his pockets of the few coins that he had, and then invited the robber to go through his saddlebags, which were filled with books. Now the disappointed robber was turning away when Wesley called out, "Stop, I have something more to give you." And then the robber turned back and Wesley said, "My friend, you may live to regret this sort of life you are living. If you ever do, remember this: the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin." The robber hurried silently away, and the man of God rode along, praying that the word spoken might be fixed in the robber's conscience. Now, years later, at the close of a Sunday evening service, a man stepped forward and asked to speak with Mr. Wesley. Now, Wesley was surprised to learn that this was the man who had robbed him years before, and he was now a well-to-do businessman. But better still, he was now a child of God. Now, God had used the words spoken that night in his conversation. Taking Wesley's hand, he affectionately kissed it and said with deep emotion, "To you, dear sir, I owe it all." And Wesley replied, no, my friend, not to me, but to the precious blood of Christ, which cleanses us from all sins." Let me close again by asking you these two questions. To what extent are you experiencing the transforming power of Jesus Christ? And secondly, to what extent are you proclaiming the transforming power of Jesus Christ? Let us pray. Lord Jesus, indeed you are the Lord of all. You are the Lord of the natural, and you are the Lord of the supernatural. For those of us who have yet to fully know you, we pray for your deliverance over them. Deliverance from the consequences and control of sin in their life. And for us who believe and follow you, we pray for you to supernaturally transform our character daily from one splendor of glory to another, more and more into the image of Jesus Christ. We declare all things are possible with you, and as we continue to experience your transforming power, may it be seen in our speech, our attitude, and our conduct. May we also passionately share to our circle of family and friends what you have done and are continuing to do. In Jesus' name we pray, Amen.
Thank you for joining this session of the Bible Explained. If you've been blessed by this study, please like and share our church Facebook page and YouTube channel so more can be blessed by God's Word. If you'd like to get connected with us, there's the comment section, or you can visit www.churchofpraise.org.my. We'll see you in the next session as we continue our reading of the book of Luke. Do read the relevant passages beforehand in order to get the best out of the study. Lastly, if you have any questions, reach out to us via equipped@churchofpraise.org.my and we will get back to you as soon as possible. Looking forward to seeing you again.